Hello and welcome to the second lecture on thoracic surgery. In the previous lecture, we learnt about the basic principles of thoracic surgery, and in this lecture, we'll cover some of the common thoracic surgical disorders. As you can see in the list, we'll learn a bit about mediastinal tumors, bronchiectasis, empyema, and lung cancer. And among these, the most important disease about which we should know is the lung cancer. One, because it is very common, and number two, because it is a commonly asked question in your exams. Lung cancer again will be covered to you in depth in various subjects. Pathologists will cover it, then the medicine will cover it, then chest physicians will cover it. So we will cover mainly the surgical aspects of a lung cancer. So lung cancer is very common. In fact, it is the most common malignancy that causes mortality, and the prevalence is high throughout the world, and it has got very high mortality, and it is more commonly seen in men as compared to women. Coming to the etiology, smoking is the main causative factor for developing lung cancers. There are also certain genetic predispositions that will make a patient more prone to getting lung cancers, and pollution, as you know, is also another etiological factor. The smoking is the main etiologic factor in developing lung cancers. Roughly about 80-95% of the patients having lung cancers are smokers. Smoking increases the risk of lung cancers by more than 2000 times. The component of the smoke of the cigarette that is thought to be carcinogenic is the tar. This is again a common MCQ. The tar is the main carcinogenic agent that produces lung cancer in cigarette smoking. Coming to the pathological types of lung cancer, lung cancers are mainly of two different types. One is small cell cancer, which constitutes about 20% of all lung cancers, and non-small cell cancer, which constitutes about 80% of lung cancers. And among non-small cell cancers, adenocarcinoma is the most common lung cancer. So this is again a very common MCQ. The most common histological type of lung cancer is an adenocarcinoma. So first we learn a bit about small cell cancers. Small cell cancers are otherwise known as Oort cell cancers because of the characteristic oat-like cells that are present in these tumors. They have homogeneous monomorphic cells arranged in clusters. That is the pathology of these tumors. These tumors metastasize very early to the lymph nodes. They also spread very early hematogenously. So these are very lethal cancers. The prognosis of small cell cancer is quite bad, and the survival is measured only in months. So they produce an interesting syndrome known as Eaton-Lambert syndrome, which is clinically very similar to myasthenia gravis. So one of the differential diagnoses of patients presenting with the myasthenia gravis is Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Another very common cause of myasthenia gravis, which some of you might know, is thymoma. So if a question comes, what is the role of say thoracic imaging and patients with myasthenia gravis, it is twofold. One is to diagnose thymomas, second is to look for small cell cancers. The surgery has very little place in these cancers because they, as we have learned, they have very early lymphatic and hematogenous spread. So surgery doesn't work for these patients, and chemotherapy is the mainstay of treatment for small cell cancers. So how do these cancers present? So lung cancers produce different types of clinical symptoms depending on the location of the tumor. For an example, if the tumor is centrally located over here and it is abutting into the trachea or the main bronchus, patient will have cough, they'll have hemoptysis, and they'll have dyspnea. On the other hand, if the tumor is present peripherally, away from the central structures, then the tumor can essentially be asymptomatic. So the clinical presentation depends on the site of the tumor. Centrally located tumors are more symptomatic and they present early, while peripherally located tumors can be asymptomatic, and we may come to know about these tumors only when metastasis happens. So only in late stages we may be able to diagnose these patients with lung cancers. So this is the list of symptoms. 50% of the patients will have hemoptysis. Patients may have cough, dyspnea, clubbing, hoarseness of voice, myopathies like what I've described in the previous slide, and small cell carcinoma presenting as Eaton-Lambert syndrome. But the most common clinical presentation of a lung cancer is that patient will be asymptomatic. So again and again we are emphasizing this clinical point, that if a patient comes to you with a cough or any respiratory symptoms, you should have a high index of suspicion and a low threshold for ordering investigations like CT scan. Otherwise, we'll pick up these patients only in very late stages when the tumor is not operable. So what are the investigations? So we have learned about various investigations in the previous class itself. Chest X-ray, that may show an advanced cancer like this. CT scan, you will all know that it is the investigation of choice for diagnosing thoracic disorders. We can do a CT guided biopsies to get to know about the histopathology of the tumor, and very rarely a mediastinoscopy is done to look for the nodal statuses, but it's not commonly done. But the most important investigation that helps us in diagnosing a lung cancer, or for that matter any problem inside the thorax, is a contrast enhanced CT scan of the chest. So how do we stage these tumors? Most of the tumors are staged using the TNM staging. T stands for the tumor characteristic, the tumor size, invasion of surrounding structures, etc. N stands for the nodal status, and M stands for the metastatic status. So you don't have to remember the in-depth staging of lung cancer, but what you have to remember is stage 1 and stage 2 tumors are operable cancers, stage 3 and stage 4 are inoperable cancer. So our endeavor should be to diagnose these patients while they are in stage 1 and stage 2 itself, and that is achieved by ordering an imaging, a CT scan, very early in the stage of the disease by maintaining high index of suspicion. So treatment depends on the size of the tumor and the location of the tumor and the stage of the tumor. Like I said, for stage 1 and stage 2 tumors, we can offer them surgery. If the tumor is confined only to one lobe, we can do a lobectomy. If the tumor is occupying the more than one lobe, then we can offer the patient a pneumonectomy. But for most of the patients, they present to us at very late stages because most of the cases are asymptomatic, and we have not ordered investigations early enough. And because of these reasons, most of these patients present very late, and only treatment we can offer this patient is palliation. So what is the prognosis of these cancers? So once a patient is diagnosed with lung cancers, 80% of them will be dead at the end of 1 year. So they're not going to see the next Christmas or next Diwali. Most of these patients won't make it to the end of 1 year. And by the end of 5 years, 95% of all the patients with lung cancers will be dead. So lung cancer, as we have learned in the first slide, is a very lethal disease. So the solution to the problem does not lie in the treatment of the disease, but by prevention of the disease. So how do we prevent lung cancers? We prevent lung cancers by preventing or decreasing smoking. So it is our responsibility to advise every patient who visits us, irrespective of the disease with which he refers to us, whether the patient is a hernia, having inguinal hernia, or hydrocele, or diabetes, or hypertension, or myocarditis, we need to take history of smoking and advise smoking cessation. So that is how we decrease the mortality from lung cancers, and not by doing surgeries. So next we move on to mediastinal tumors. Mediastinal tumors are fairly uncommon, but then they have a propensity to appear in large numbers in your MCQs. So some of the most common MCQs that are asked is, which is the commonest tumor in each mediastinum? What's the commonest tumor in anterior mediastinum, middle mediastinum, posterior mediastinum, etc., etc.? So in the superior mediastinum or in the anterior mediastinum, contains very few organs. It contains basically a thymus and lymphoma. So the most common tumor that occurs in anterior mediastinum is a thymoma. And whenever you find thymoma, you should look for myasthenia gravis in those patients. And similarly, whenever you encounter myasthenia gravis, you have to look for thymoma in those patients. So the commonest tumor of anterior mediastinum is a thymoma. The superior mediastinum, the only structures that are there are the lymph nodes, and rarely the retrosternal thyroid can get into the superior mediastinum. But the commonest tumor of the superior mediastinum is a lymphoma. And in the posterior mediastinum, you can see here that this is the vertebral body, and if you can imagine, all the nerve roots will come from the intervertebral face over here. So these nerves can develop neurogenic tumors like neurofibroma, and that is the commonest tumor of the posterior mediastinum. Middle mediastinum, it is very rare to develop any tumors because it mainly contains the heart, the pericardium, and its structures. Rarely you can get atrial myxomas, but they are very rare. So how do they present? Just like all thoracic disorders, these patients can be asymptomatic, or they may present to us with superior vena cava syndrome because of the pressure applied by these tumors on the superior vena cava. And you can see that this patient has got a facial edema and petechial hemorrhages over there. So this is a feature of a superior vena cava syndrome. So again, the investigation of choice in these patients is a CT scan. You can see this patient has got a superior mediastinal enlargement, and you can see the outlining of the lymph nodes. This is probably a lymphoma as seen on a chest X-ray. So here you can see this is the trachea that is bifurcated into the main stem bronchus. This is the ascending aorta, and this is a tumor that is in front of the aorta and behind the sternum. So this is most probably an anterior mediastinal mass, probably a thymoma. So this is how thymoma looks. And treatment, surgery is the mainstay in the treatment of all these diseases. If you are suspecting lymphoma, we can do a CT guided biopsy, and depending on the histopathology of the tumor, we can institute therapy for lymphoma. For all other tumors like thymoma and neurogenic tumors in the posterior mediastinum or atrial myxomas, the treatment of choice is surgical excision. Empyema. So what is empyema? Empyema is a collection of pus within a thickened pleural cavity along with fibrosis. So three components are required for diagnosing empyema. One is presence of pus, second is presence of pleural thickening and fibrosis. If there is only pus and there is no pleural thickening and fibrosis, that condition is known as a pyothorax. So presence of pleural thickening and fibrosis constitutes empyema. So what are the causes of empyema? There are many causes you can see in this list. Probably you can take a screenshot and then keep. But the commonest cause of empyema is residual pulmonary infection. And second most common cause is trauma. So these two are the common causes of empyema. The clinical presentation of this case, empyema, depends on the underlying cause. So for an example, patients may have symptoms of the underlying pneumonia. They may have history of trauma, etc. Apart from that, these patients will have pain over the involved hemithorax, fever because the patient is having pus inside. They may be breathless because the underlying lung is compressed by the collection of pus, these patients also will be malnourished and anemic because of the nature of the, because these patients are having this chronic ailment. So investigations are the same. You can first we will order a chest x-ray. You can see here that this patient is having a whiteout of the right hemithorax. There are no lung markings, but then the trachea is not shifted to the opposite side. This is because even though there is a mass lesion, fluid accumulation trying to push the lung from the right side to the left side, the fibrosis that is associated with the empyema is preventing the lung from going to the opposite side. And also, unlike an effusion where we saw that there will be a meniscus sign, in patients with empyema there won't be meniscus, and this is because the pus is enclosed in a fibrotic cavity, so meniscus will not be present. So CT scan of course will give you a clear picture about the number of loculi. You can see that this is the thickened pleura, this mark over there, and these are the septations inside the empyema cavity, and these are accumulations of the pus along with pockets of air. So this is a typical CT finding in a patient with empyema. So we can also do a culture. We can aspirate this person, send for culture. Then most common organisms that will be isolated from empyema will be a staphylococcus or a streptococcus. So the treatment of empyema is like treatment of pus anywhere. We will do a make an incision and drain the pus. So this may entitle for in simple cases of empyema, we can drain the pus simply by placing a chest tube, like what you have seen in the video in the previous session. And if the pus is very thick and it won't come through the chest tube, we can excise a rib and leave the wound open. So we can do a rib excision, and if the lung is trapped and it won't expand because of the fibrosis, then we do a surgery known as decortication, where we peel away the visceral pleura from the underlying lung. So this visceral pleura, which is thickened and fibrotic, is preventing the lung from expanding. The principle behind decortication is that we peel away this restricting layer of thickened pleura from the underlying lung, thus allowing the lung to expand. So that's the principle of decortication, and decortication is a surgery of choice for patients who are having empyema. But the first line of treatment of empyema is drainage, either with a thoracic, with a intercostal tube drain, or by excision of the rib. So these are the various options that are available for us for treating empyema. Drainage with a intercostal tube drain for uncomplicated cases, excision of ribs, and decortication if the lung is trapped and if it is not, the pleural cavity, the fibrotic pleural cavity is not allowing the lung to expand. So these are the various surgical options for empyema. Bronchiectasis, again this will be covered to you by the physicians. Bronchiectasis for most parts is always treated with by medical means. Surgery is only very rarely indicated. We'll look at the indications for surgery in the next slide. So the common causes of bronchiectasis in our country are tuberculosis and post pneumonia. It can also be there without any cause, idiopathic, and patients with cystic fibrosis. Patient with cystic fibrosis will have extensive bronchiectasis and will usually be bilateral, while post pneumonia and tuberculosis bronchiectasis will most likely be localized to one lobe of the lung, or at the most to one lung. So the commonest site of tuberculosis bronchiectasis is the right middle lobe. Otherwise, the commonest site of bronchiectasis is the left lower lobe. So this is again sometimes asked as MCQs for you. So the clinical symptoms, these patients will present with chronic cough lasting for usually decades. They produce copious amounts of sputum because the bronchus is dilated and it can generate lot of sputum. So these patients will have sputum output of say 100 to 300 ml of sputum. And when the infection becomes severe and the mucosa gets eroded, these patients can present with hemoptysis. So investigation again, chest x-ray will show you this tramp track signs and soap bubble appearance. So these are characteristic findings of bronchiectasis. So in this patient, it is bilateral. Even though the left lung is fairly normal, there are also small pockets of bronchiectasis over here. And the right lower lobe is severely bronchiectatic. So when you do a CT scan on these patients, again you can see that CT scan is very diagnostic for most of the thoracic disorders. You can see that this is a case of left lower lobe bronchiectasis, which we have discussed as a case of is the commonest site for developing bronchiectasis. So you can CT scan is diagnostic as far as bronchiectasis is concerned. So how do we treat these patients? We treat them if it is bilateral, there is no role for surgery because they can't remove both the lungs. If it is localized to one lobe and the patient is very symptomatic, in the sense they are having recurrent episodes of exacerbation of COPD symptoms, which is not getting controlled with medications, or they are having massive hemoptysis and recurrent episodes of hemoptysis, that will be indication of surgery. So bronchiectasis not controlled by medical management and hemoptysis are two indications for surgery in patients with bronchiectasis. The commonest surgery we do in bronchiectasis is a lobectomy, because most of this diseases are localized to one lobe and we can just remove the diseased lobe and get away with it. So the last specific disorder that we deal with is known as primary spontaneous pneumothorax. This is an extremely uncommon condition, but this disease makes a common occurrence in your final year exams. So there can be a short note on primary spontaneous pneumothorax. So what is primary spontaneous pneumothorax? As the name implies, primary, anything in primary in medicine means we don't know the actual cause, primary hypertension and things like that. So this is a pneumothorax that occurs without any known cause and it is spontaneous. It is not secondary to trauma or any violent coughing, and this pneumothorax develops spontaneously. So that is why it is known as primary spontaneous pneumothorax. So these patients can present to the casualty. Usually these are young, fit individuals, athletic individuals who present with a sharp pleuritic pain and breathlessness, and we may think of myocardial infarction in these patients. It's quite difficult to diagnose because it can easily confuse with other disorders, and we are not expecting pneumothorax in this patient. But if we do an imaging, we may know that these patients are having a pneumothorax. So the x-ray of one such patient, you can see that there are no lung markings at all. The lung is collapsed to the mediastinum over here and the trachea is deviated to the opposite side. So you'll get a picture of pneumothorax. So etiology, as I told you, it is not known. So this occurs in young individuals, 75% of them are men. It runs in families. In some of the patients, they have what is known as a bullous disease of the lung. You can see here in this CT scan, this is a normal lung and there are bullae that are there. These are congenital bullae that is there in the right lung of this patient. So this bullae can, when the patient runs or exerts himself, can break and the air can leak into the pleural cavity and produce this primary spontaneous pneumothorax. But in many patients with primary spontaneous pneumothorax, there are no cause found at all, not even this bullae. So the commonest site where you will find bullae in these patients with this kind of pneumothorax is the apex of the upper lobe, again a common MCQ. So these are the points to take. How do we treat these patients with primary spontaneous pneumothorax? The patient is comfortable and is stable. We monitor the patient. We monitor his SpO2, and if he's stable, then we may discharge the patient without any intervention. On the contrary, if the patient becomes dyspneic and his SpO2 is falling, we treat the patient simply by inserting a intercostal tube drain. So that will solve the problem. So if the patient comes to us with recurrent episodes of this spontaneous pneumothorax, say the patient is coming for the second or the third time, and if the CT scan is showing bulle, we can treat these patients by excising these bulle. This surgery is known as bullectomy. And if the patient is coming with a recurrent episode of primary spontaneous pneumothorax and we do not find any bulle on the imaging, then we can do something known as pleurodysis, where we fuse the pleural cavity by instilling chemical agents like talc or tetracycline. So that will eliminate the possibility of the patient developing pneumothorax. So that completes the lecture on thoracic surgery, and that also completes the surgical lectures for your this semester. We will get in touch with you regarding the lectures for the next semester.